Right.
So when people tell me, you know, I saw Bigfoot, or I saw, you know, the UFO lights, or I'm seeing spirits, or I'm seeing these anthropomorphic creatures, you know, I tend to believe them, but then there is a side to me that says, well, that's a visionary state, and all humans experience that. So really, from my skeptic friend's point of view, when I explain it as a visionary state, and that spirits are just a part of our subconscious, and it's like a Carl Jung universal archetype experience, everyone's happy. But I know what I experience, and I'm sure when people have their experiences, which I feel are visionary spirits, I'm sure when they have their experiences, it's absolutely real to them. Absolutely real. I mean, you look at these things and you can see the detail of the liquid of the eye, or the eyelashes, or the fingerprints on the finger. I mean, you see detail like that, and it looks very real. As if it's standing in the physical world.
Right. Now, is that something that when you were a child that you went through a certain line of learning how to do things? I mean, I know that you we've talked about it before, where you say you've got to learn how to heal plants, and then
Well, most people that go into mystery tradition, or you know, even indigenous people, will tell you the spirits do the teaching. So now, science guys, you know, my skeptical friends, plug your ears again, because this is not, you know, from a science standpoint. This is just me telling my story, my experience. But you learn from the spirits. And so my teachers, or whatever, you know, I don't want to lend anything but dignity to the experience, because, you know, you and I have seen people saying they talk to unseen beings, and it's not very dignified. It gets pretty cheesy.
Right.
But the experience I had was an elegant experience, and it was with beings that, to me, were wise and knowledgeable, a part of nature. They were forces. There was nothing cheesy or cartoonish about it.
Right.
So it was very serious to me. And they teach you first, as in most indigenous traditions, you know, you learn in steps. So you learn to understand certain principles. And what I find is, across the board, when I grew up, it was indigenous. It was very close to nature speak, right?
Right.
As I grew up and started to study other cultures and other mystery traditions, I found that everybody had the same concepts and ideas. They just used different terms and words for them. Everyone had a spot of the fawn somewhere near them. It wasn't just an indigenous American thing. Everyone, you know, you go to Egypt and they speak of power places, and in Egypt it's even more epic, because these people were building them. They knew the geomancy of it all. They were able to take the specific geology and find the specific places and build these, you know, fantastical structures, which were all based on the premise of a person becoming visionary.
Right.
And getting the knowledge.
Yeah. And I think that that's a key thing to remember for most people is that, you know, when people talk about these things, it is interesting that we have found so much. I think that it's that, in a lot of ways, a lot of our traditions are very similar. You know, I was raised in a little village in Ireland, and we, you know, learned some things about stones and everything. We went through that progression, and then you learned stories and things like that. So whereas you get the basic knowledge, and then the stories are the allegorical tales that sort of lead you into the ideas of going or moving forward, but most of these things where you're moving forward is your own progression. It's not necessarily somebody else's.
Right. And when I speak of spirits, I mean, we can also remember, look at spirits. What are spirits? Are they our own subconscious teaching us and reaching out to us? is it our own subconscious, or are they autonomous and conscious beings? To me, it doesn't really matter. I don't give a crap. It is something important that has improved my life enormously. But, you know, for your audience, the term allegory means story or picture with a hidden meaning. So one of the things across the board that in all cultures is they understood that nature had a language. You know, some people can compare that to sacred geometry. But if you look at petroglyphs and you look at all the ancient symbols of the mystery schools, you still see them today in secret societies or in Freemasonry. Freemasonry is amazing with the use of symbols, ancient symbols, and the understanding of them.
Right. And also I think that some people don't necessarily incorporate the sounds and vibrations as much in these locations. It seems to me that
they do. We just don't hear about it because people see it happening, but they don't understand what it is. Mm-hmm. Native Indigenous America people did it all the way everywhere across the world, especially in Egypt. There's God, I wish I remember his name. He just sent a post recently on my page. I'm sorry, person, whoever you are. But he did research on the sounds and the tones in the structures of Egypt. But you see it all over the place. And of course, you know, that is the principle of vibration and hermetic principles. And so with the hermetic principles, you see that all over the world and all global cultures. They don't call them hermetic principles, but they are all the same principles that reflect knowledge and correspondence to the universe or natural law.
Right.
So I don't know if your listeners are really even interested in this. What they want to know probably is, well, why did I see a Bigfoot? And if I saw a Bigfoot and it's visionary, then that means it's not real. No, yes, I think it is real.
Right.
But it's your first gate. You know, it for me, growing up with a Native tradition was my first gate.
Right.
So a lot of people have a different first gate than mine. They may see a UFO or they may see a Bigfoot. And that's your invitation from the earth, from nature, from the big thing, the big mind, the all that is, the creator, God, whatever you want to call it. That's your invitation to study and to go deeper and to learn about your inner world. You know, that is your invitation to learn about yourself and grow your soul through study and experience of the spiritual nature.
Well, I think it is interesting, and I the reason that I wanted to talk about that a little bit, Alyssa, is because to a certain degree, experiencers such as you, and to a little less degree me, but you know, you can see this that people who experience one thing seem to experience everything. And that's the thing that I think is hard.
I've been saying that for years. If you experience one thing, you're either not being honest or you just don't feel comfortable coming out and saying, yeah, I saw the orbs too. I've seen a ghost in my life. I've seen an orb at another time in my life. Or I've seen, you know, other things mishmashed around because today we want to be very purist in science. And people approach Bigfoot or ufology or even ghost hunting as kind of sciencey now.
Right.
You know, they don't see it as a first gate, which invites you to study deeper. All these things are random. They don't perform as a circus. You can't put them in a laboratory and test them. They're very personal. The experiences are meant for you.
Right.
They're also precognitive. You know, they know what you're going to do. Well, that might be because it's part your consciousness and part spirit. So there's a saying that spirit needs us as much as we need them in the indigenous circles to project into our reality. So consciousness is a really crazy, deep, inexplicable, extraordinary, magnificent thing. Right. In all the mystery schools, consciousness is the intent. It's the animating principle. It's the most important part of care. You know, care is the magical thing that always takes people into a place where they can manifest in the magical circles. Or all of the traditions and all the schools talk about consciousness. You look at alchemy, which is chemistry, as an allegory for consciousness, for the journey of, you know, raising your consciousness from lead to the diamond body. In alchemy, everyone has heard of the Philosopher's Stone. Even your audience, I'm sure everyone in your audience has heard of the Philosopher's Stone, where it was said that they would take that base metal and turn it into gold, but that is an allegory for taking the base consciousness and turning it into enlightened consciousness.
Well, it's in the very first Harry Potter novel.
Is it? I never saw Harry Potter. I'm sorry.
Well, they called it.
Everyone always asks me, did you see Lord of the Rings? Or see Harry Potter? You know, all these things. And I really haven't. But if they've got it in there, then go see the movie. That's great.
But it is funny that in Britain that was actually called Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, and then when
that's right, I have heard of that.
Yeah, and Nicholas Flamel came up with the idea, and so
yeah, you know, whenever we put those things in a movie, it sort of takes away the specialness of it, I guess you could say, because again. It's like I one of my pet peeves is seeing this type of stuff put into the cheese factor, you know, that's just goofy. Well, it's to me, you know, when I look at all of it across the board, the same information, it is like a journey to know thyself. And, you know, if you want to know the universe, like the old saying says, know thyself first.
Yeah.
Which again is a hermetic principle, though.
So. Yeah, but I have to stick up for Hollywood a little bit, just simply because of the fact that I think that a lot of times.
Because you're a geek.
Well, yeah. Well, I am a geek, but also because of the fact that it drops in pieces of history,
yeah,
and keeps it alive.
Yeah.
It's an interesting thing.
And thank effing God for that, huh?
Yeah.
It's disappearing.
If you think about the Green Man, is a very, very old British, idea. You know, the idea that nature comes alive and looks after the forest and all those different things. Well, as the Green Man progressed through time and you couldn't talk about that anymore because that was so, quote unquote, pagan. You know, you see the grand coming into the stories of King Arthur. So, Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. Well, the Green Knight is
right. Yes. Right.
And Robin Hood and the Merry Men. I mean, people think Robin Hood was a real person. He's not. He's really an allegorical story for the Green Man, and most people can't see past that. This is the idea of a lot of things, and you know, so these things come through because they are old ideas, and you know, rather than just saying, well, let's just forget that idea, somebody somewhere will drop it into a story every once in a while and make people look for it. It's an interesting thing to find out that I think a lot of the mystery teachings are in different types of literature that we don't know.
So look at it this way. So someone sees Bigfoot, they're questioning, is it real, is it not real? And then they hear someone like you speaking about the Green Man, and then that's interesting. And then they go further than that, and they go into study, you know, some of the mysteries. And then the mysteries lead them around to, you know, the ancient psychology, really, which is learning about your inner worlds and yourself and shedding your ego and all of that, you know, higher minded stuff. So again, it's a first gate, the paranormal that the mainstream calls the paranormal or the supernatural is a first gate.
Right.
It takes you down a path of very unique and personal studies. We all study different things, but we all eventually